Boy, you're welcome.
To the barber shop.
You're welcome.
To the barber shop.
Barbershop Podcast, coming to you live from Box O Studio in the shadow of the Hamilton Mountain in that great city that is Hamilton, Ontario, the blast furnace of live, original music, creativity, and drive. This is the most driven city. It has been driven. It's been driven hard, you know, but regular maintenance, a little love, TLC, goes a long way to making it the vibrant hotspot that it is. I cannot effuse efficiently and sufficiently about how much I love Hamilton, Ontario. Almost as much as I love Ryan Cannon and Gary Greenland. And not so much
Thanks.
Gary. I kind of like Gary a lot, but I love Ryan.
Thanks, buddy.
I've been friends and partners for years, and I'm going to throw the ball to you a little bit right now. I was assuming you had a microphone, so I'm glad it worked out that you have a microphone tonight. And first of all, talk about a little announcement that you're gonna be going have a little more time available here on the studio. No, this is big because when we had this idea and these talks about what we wanted to do here, the kind of multimedia platform that we envisioned growing Box O Studio into, you had just after years of being part time at one of the health providers, the big hospitals in town, unnamed. You went full time and threw yourself into that, and heroes to you. And you got married, and you handled a lot of man stuff.
It was like man stuff. Doing a lot of man stuff.
The man stuff kind of took over, and for 4 years, I handed to you that we were able to kind of chip away at what we have here at Box O Studio and at Barbershop Podcast. And now you're able to kind of, technologically and creatively,
and we've already
than they are.
We've already fixed a lot of stuff since then. Too.
I know.
We fixed a lot of things today.
It is so really kind of because one of tonight's guests is really an expert in a bunch of ways. So it was great having him in.
His expertise didn't contribute to the
not
problem.
Too much. It was more like a little elbow grease.
I wasn't strong enough to push the cable all the way in.
You needed someone with a tight T-shirt and a bulging muscle set. To come in and help you with that. But I'm going to throw it to you because we've had these boys by before. I've got to know them and appreciate what monsters they are creatively, musically, what great, humble individuals they are. But I met them through you, and you know them better than me. So tell us about Slo Motions, their origins, and like who the fuck are these guys?
Oh, they're a bunch of guys that I know and have been working for years in different outfits and different projects. They were four members of Page and the Wolves that were on here. I can't remember if they came on with anything else. Adam was here for the
drummer
drum
special.
Episode.
That's
drummer
right.
special.
Yeah. This is his third episode. Yeah.
Third episode. They're good buddies of mine, incredibly talented musicians. I'm going to get to show off some of my work tonight. I've done music videos for them.
They're really connected with either the covers when they're doing Motown or doing the originals. A really nice blend. They're going to have a good insight into the music scene, what clicks and what doesn't, what makes it work. And they're still young enough that there won't be too many stories of contemplations of suicide and or mass murder. You know, it's not always exclusive.
Yeah, I don't know if we've had Corey on the show before. So
no,
we'll
Corey,
see.
You haven't been on the show before, Corey? No, we've had almost 1,000 people on the show, so, you know, he could have slipped in, but apparently this is we're going somewhere tonight. We're going somewhere fresh, and Ryan loves fresh. We all do. Barbershop Podcast, fresh every Wednesday. Live Twitch TV, not every Wednesday, 99% of most Wednesdays. Yeah. Or check us out on YouTube. Or
they go up eventually.
They do. There's over 200 there. And tonight will slot itself in somewhere. It's a special Saturday show. Normally we go Wednesdays. We have a special Saturday afternoon show today. So if you're with us on Twitch TV, thanks for joining us. And if you're watching it on YouTube later, remember to like, subscribe. That's how, you know, we get famous and wealthy, right? Ryan, did you work yourself through the the pile of money this week? I got stuck.
I haven't got my paycheck
Really?
Week, so I meant to talk to you about
that. Man. Okay. Well, it could have been the truck driver strike, the dump trucks. It takes a look.
Dump truck full of cash.
Full of cash and make it. All right. Enough jocularity. Enough time. Now you get some real entertainment. And as we said, the band this time around is Slo Motions. All right. And we got Corey, we got Adam, and we got Pete, and they are great guys. I want to welcome you to the studio. How you guys doing?
Hey, Kev.
Good to see you.
We're doing awesome.
Yeah. So every time we come back, it's just a little more professional, a little more crazy.
Oh, yeah. It's another guitar. Yeah,
something, right? But you got early on, like, the what this was, right? Like, you kind of were, and I want to talk about this, all you guys. You're of the age, and you kind of have the mind, not only creatively, see? But also, you know, the left side, the technological, the mathematical, to say, is this going to work? And you seem to be fairly successful at knowing what works and what doesn't. So tying in what this band's doing now, tell us what you're doing and why you're doing it, what it kind of ties into. And we'll assume that everyone else has got an interest in where we are up to this point, musically speaking.
Yeah, so what we're sort of up to now, well, we just did our CD release. So that sort of cycle of getting the band sort of
did you
launched.
Come in with songs semi-completed from other projects? Things have been floating around for a while. What was the genesis of the musical content of Slo Motions?
Just pretty much Adam and I having some conversations about let's write some
So it's all it was
songs
all new
again.
Material from the time you decided to make a band.
Pretty much, yeah. Pretty much started with Adam and I just having talks about doing an original thing again. We kind of taken a break for a bit, did the whole cover band thing, played lots of gigs, and then him and I were just like, let's just do this, go back to our roots, play some, you know, hard rock, and take what we learned from playing in the cover bands and do. Yep. So it kind of started with just him and I, and then we kind of had that. We didn't have any songs. We wrote the songs from that sort of goal, like, you know what I mean? It's like, let's have the vision first, then try and write some songs. So it was trying to really upbeat, almost dancey, straight up rock, simple, you know.
Yeah.
We've had a lot of different incarnations though with this.
Yeah.
Like, it's been like, even Corey has been on
in and out of this.
Well, he's been in the freak show for a while, right?
Yeah.
Like, it's you know, we've kind of been joined at the hip for a while, but
10 years now.
Yeah.
9 years?
Yeah. Feels like 40.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
So, like, we have done a couple different versions of this, but I think we finally got it to stick within the last year or so.
Yeah.
At first, like Pete and I went to Fanshawe for the Music Industry Arts Program, which ties into the technological thing that you said, which I find super fascinating and... that's a good connection between Ryan and I, where we can nerd out and talk about stuff like that.
Yeah.
But yeah, so like we did that program, and then another friend of ours, Mike Monson, we played in that cover band that was mentioned before. We were on the podcast right almost as soon as you guys started this.
Yeah.
And like Pete said, we sort of learned a lot by playing like Bee Gees and Rod Stewart and James Brown and stuff like that. And then, you know, took that and stirred it together with some of our roots and have come up with some fun, catchy.
Yeah. And you don't even have to be very cloying about it. It's not like you're saying, okay, I've got the formula. I'm going to like get the 11 herbs and spices. It's just, you saw what lit up the dance floor and it lit you up and the energy that was got passed around the stage. And so is it a couple drinky riffology that feels good? That's right on top of that. Or is there songs that were aching for a music to go with it? Or is it a combination?
Yeah, there was, I think, a couple songs that were written sort of in the jam space. You know, we had another guitar player. Our friend Evan was playing with us for a while, and he had a guitar riff. And then we sort of wrote the song in the space. But some songs I would have...
Well, I remember the one, though, that we made the video for that we'll probably play later, No Better.
Yeah.
That was from a sound check.
Yeah.
Like, that was totally... That riff, the main riff.
Out of the air, yeah.
I had that lick.
Fresh. That came from a sound check when we were doing a New Year's show or something.
Yeah. And I was like, oh, let's remember that for later.
Yeah.
It's good. And it's because so many times it's like it's not the chords, it's the syncopation. It's that, and you can't really even describe it, what makes it different and why that thing you played yesterday doesn't sound the same.
Right. So, yeah, it's hard to, sometimes it's hard to like latch on.
Being a drummer, it's important that you have both of that because someone remembers there's a certain
feeling to where something is supposed to be played.
Tied into a math, you know, there's a biomath that's got to do, you know, and I want to touch on this. I'm serious because I battle with the formula, non-formula thing, music originality, you know, what's original. There's 8 notes, you know, how you play it.
Right.
And how I came to certain music, right? And you're always only in the stream, in the center of the stream, where it's really fast moving for so long.
Right.
And you're certainly like 3 people I've met who are kind of the age and the knowledge where you've earned your sarcasm if you have any of a way that things really are. So I'm gonna talk to you, Cory. How did you, you know, talking about sarcasm, I mean, there must have been certain elements other than the sheer musicality that drew you to this band. Did they approach you and say, we want another guitar player, can you, like, what?
Well, like, when we first met, I met Pete at a party in Brantford, a birthday party, and I just took note, and then I saw Adam play another night in a project called Radio Silence, which you guys were both involved in
at different
parts. Yeah, so you guys played the Casbah, and I saw Adam play, and they smashed out this Foo Fighters cover, and it was so good, and I just walked right up on stage like I owned it, and I was like, "Hey man, your drumming's really good. I like you. Want to be my friend?"
Don't be afraid.
Yeah. And then I was doing this other. I was helping facilitate this project that my friend Alex Cadet did called the Beautiful Souls Orchestra, and we used to rehearse in the upper floor of the Corktown. Jesse Dorr was managing at the time.
I love Jesse.
And so I was like, hey, these guys are great players. Let's get them in on this, like, experiment, you know, this kind of, like, sociological experiment band thing. And they were great. And then they were writing in this project called Magnetic Love and recording with, like, Carl. And then, we did stuff with Mike Monson.
Yeah.
And then at the time when we were rehearsing all that stuff, like, they started the Virginia Woolf stuff, the cover band gig. And it kind of like Magnetic Love like fizzled out. And so then I was like, okay, I'm going to do some other stuff. And then just came up like last year around the beginning of the year. Like, we started.
Well, you went on a crazy journey yourself.
Yeah.
Playing in like Sons 2014.
Yeah. And I'm 30. I've been playing the scene since I was 15.
Keep stoking, right? There's just another layer, a thin layer of experience and people and influences and kind of all comes to bear on. You know, a sound, right?
For sure.
And do you feel listened, or like, are they bullies? They appear to be like bullies to me, right? They're both really good looking guys. They probably hog all the women, right? And they're like, they're you know, how do you make yourself, you know, be known amongst these megalomaniacs?
Yeah, well, they're actually really, like, I was thinking about it when I went on tour and stuff. And when I came back from the tour, I was like really not digging the people that I was playing with. Like it just wasn't vibing the way I wanted it to.
Yeah.
And so I started to think about like what mattered to me, and I was like, you know what? I really love those guys.
Yeah.
You know, and I want to play with them.
Yeah.
So I've been thinking about it for like,
it's pure fun and a bit of love,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And it comes through. Like when I hear anything you guys do, it's like, wow, it disarms you. Like, how can you be against that? How can you be such a hater?
Yeah.
You know, there's just not enough. And it's like, there's not enough hate for you guys. You know? It's like you Slow Motion.
Slow Motion
crushes hate.
So once we get more YouTube videos up, the comment section.
We'll watch it light up.
Yeah, trolling and all that stuff.
All right.
Well, I figure if we got some hate, though, we're doing well, right?
You're doing good. Yeah, you're getting the response. Well, I've always loved the harmonies, the way you guys sing and like approach that as an instrument, how important it is, and the quality musicianship. So we're going to start off with a live tune. That's what our tradition is. What's the first one you're going to do for us tonight?
A new song called Leaving With Nothing.
Leaving With Nothing. Is it self-explanatory, or are you going to explain it musically, or do you have anything you want to tell us to key us off on this song?
There's not so much in certain... There's a bunch of different things in there, I guess.
Nudges and nuances.
Some songs have like a really... I have a really certain theme I'm going for, maybe lyrically. This song's... There's a little bit of stream consciousness, a little bit of... but some of it, you know, some of it probably doesn't make sense. I don't know.
All right. Well, I'm sure it's going to make plenty of sense because you're going to hear it right here, right now, live on barbershoppodcast.com. Barbershoppodcast.com, your source of this kind of magic. There's so many episodes, well over 200. Go check it out yourself. Feel the love, hear the love in high definition and high fidelity. Want to talk quality? I want to talk quality. I want to talk about our great sponsor over there at Hamilton Artists. Hamilton Artists, Urban Hamilton Artists, hamiltonartists.ca. The actual store is right there at 627 Main Street East in Hamilton, Ontario, between Sanford and Burris. You can reach them at 289-396-1653. Their number is there. You're going to be able to see it. And check it out. Look at the kind of quality merchandise they have. They have hats. They have shirts. They have banners. They have pens. They have tags. If you need something printed on something, they are the people to do it. They've got a crazy laser-burning thing where you can bring your own mug and get the back of your acoustic guitar just like etched with your own face. So if anyone rips you off, you can say, that's my guitar. It's like, how do you know? It's like, it's got my fucking face on the back of it. Like, it's just crazy. They're creative people. They're good people. They're with us. You know, support local. Make the economy grow. The people, they sell original live music there. You can get all kinds of, you got a CD, you go drop it off, you're an artist, you go, you know, they'll sell it there at Hamilton Artists. There's a growing collection of the kind of quality stuff. And then eventually you're going to want your shit put on some shit, you know, and they do it. They do it. They're really good at it. All right. Slo Motions here. Let's talk about that, the mechanics of music. You know, you can, like I said, you can afford to be cynical, and I meant that there's to make an art form viable. You know, it's like, first of all, especially in your youth, it's got to be fun. So it's like, all right, I'm going to suffer the slings and arrows financially or otherwise because it's fun, and we do that for our fun. Right. But it's also a serious business because you've realized it's like, I have a gift. I'm good at this. There's no reason why, especially in this, the way that the game used to be, you know, even in, you guys are young guys, right? But you've seen it change so much on your watch, and the way it used to be, how things worked and how you booked and how you got paid and how you recorded and how it got out there. And there's a constant rotation of that.
Yeah.
How's the business side? Are you, you know, up for that? You can just consider that part of the music business now. Do you look at that when you get into a project like this, or is it just still, is it fun or not? Like, what's your criteria?
It's a fine balance, like, for me. Like, things that I've noticed, like, when my focus has been just on the money, it kind of sucks the passion and the fun out of it, or has a tendency to do that, especially if you're relying on it, like, as your main thing.
Income, yeah, what you do to survive.
Yeah, right? So, like, I think I'll speak for all of us, and correct me if I'm wrong, but, like, the reason why we're playing in this project now is really because we want to have fun and play music together. You know, and we still have to think about, like, social media and the business aspect and all that stuff.
For sure. And someone's got to be good at it or be able to have somebody who's into the band. This is what a lot of people don't realize. You've worked a lot. You got a lot more fans than you realize. If you're not good at social media, put it out on what limited social media you have and say, well, someone can do my accounts. Can someone handle my? And there's people out there that say, sure, I know how to make a page. I know how to make an event. I know how to, you know, people help you out, you know, who want to be involved in the music business and, you know, making 1,000 posters and going out and wrapping around. You still might want to do that, but, you know, that's all I remember the early days of Facebook. Yeah, for sure. I remember the early days of Facebook. It was like, wow, 100 people are going to come to my show, right? And
confirmed.
It's like, and it's like, yeah, confirmed. Yeah, I can't believe.
They are going to be there.
Yeah.
And then I've accepted the 10% rule. It's like that's a solid 10 people. That's cool, you know, but that's it, like, realistically. Yeah. And I hate, you know, I want to be an up guy. I want to give love to this, fuel to this industry, but it's everything they say it is. And this is one of the hardest towns where the quality is here. The competition is here, and the money and the opportunities, not so much, you know?
Yeah. I think it's exactly what Corey said, though. It's like, this is sort of like our passion project. And like, even, we were just talking about this last night when we got together. You know, if it morphs into something more than that, I certainly would run with it if it did, but I don't think that's our intention.
You're not holding anything back anyway. It's for sure. You're like, and I think that's probably with everything you do, but when you feel it,
in your
heart, in your head, there was something you wanted to do that was original project, that was fun, that was good, and you're feeling it for sure. This is it. I don't think anyone's sitting in the chair right now going, yeah, this is a good stepping stone on where I want, you know, that may be the case.
I think we've taken the stepping stones to get here.
And this is it.
Yeah.
So let's talk about this. This is the baby. You guys are studio rats, so, you know. So you, more than other people, you can talk about the process of
you
making
it. You can see
it,
my very well-used copy of my own CD there.
Yeah, cool, this one has the love. this one has the love in it with
heavy
the
tattoo. That one's the Spinal Tap cover, too. It's a little off-center, so we had to get them reprinted.
Yes. So, yeah,
so that's
a limited edition.
That's a limited edition out there.
So this is so, and I got to say, I have a huge collection of original Hamilton music, and there's a story now that comes with this one.
I like that.
There you go. So talk about.
No one else will be able to get that.
Was the recording pretty pain-free and joyous?
Yeah, well, the way we did it was, we did it pretty much all ourselves. Aside from one day at Catherine North, which was awesome. I love that studio and know the guys well that run that place. We were fortunate enough to track it to tape, too, which is something that we'd...
It was the first time ever doing that for us.
Drums and bass, at least.
Yeah. Yeah, so all the bass and drums were done in sort of one, whatever it was, 7-hour session at Catherine North. But yeah, the tape was something that I know we wanted to try for a while. And we're
it's
into kind
nice
of
to have it
sounds.
On your resume, yeah. But they, you know, you and I argue over a percentile that doesn't exist in the
well,
real
yeah.
world
if,
about
if anything,
finite
the tapes,
sound.
The tapes we were like recording to were like had like a million other things recorded yeah. on them, so it wasn't yeah. like they were like the highest pristine quality. If
yeah.
anything, they were like degraded.
Yeah, quality. Yeah, it sure. wasn't anything to do with no. being like no. you know.
I recorded
an
on
audio
two inch of Catherine North, and I'm so glad I did. It yeah. was one of those great things that's on a bucket list.
For sure,
yeah.
like everyone should do.
It was just a neat function. Like we weren't looking at the computer at all.
Yeah, but that was it's clearly that's a great like talking about natural reverb. That's just a great room that wow. if you have a feel that you're
yeah.
trying to get across, that's
so
a good
drums
room
are,
to,
yeah, the
to
drums
put
are
it
huge
in. Right
in that room.
Yeah. All right, the one we're gonna play off, the first we're gonna kick off with is "Got It Made." So tell us about "Got It Made." Is this about the story of now that you're here, like everyone else could fuck off and you got it made? And they can go to hell, right?
Yeah, yeah, I think
pretty much.
Yeah, well, no, yeah, exactly. I got it made. Yeah, no, it was me. Maybe sometimes I don't believe, or you know, you forget that even though maybe you know you do have it made, especially us over
it's
here in
true.
This country.
You got to be thankful for what you got.
So maybe there's a bit of me like I don't believe that, but I was trying to tell myself
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
But then some of the things, you know, just be me being grateful for. You know, there's a yeah. couple lines in there about my job and stuff yeah. like that. Maybe they're a little tongue in cheek. But for the most part, just trying to write a positive song about how I feel about myself, at least lyrically. You
yeah,
know?
Well said. Yeah. Well said, because you can't get anywhere until you take that first step and you'd be grateful for the things that you do have, right?
That's right.
And sometimes it feels tough, but it's true. See, these guys are soothsayers and soothsingers. And right here, right now, barbershoppodcast.com. That's it. hard stops? Are you guys like fans of the hard stop? You know, is it
once in a while?
Once
sure.
in a while.
Sometimes you got to do the big.
There's really two options. There's the and the.
I like stopping on a dime sometimes because people are grooving, and then like at a live show, it's like, you know, there's that silence that's so magical, and then people erupt.
Well, getting like really the R&B and the Motown stuff down so good as you do, like, what's the kind of lessons of the biometrics of music that you've kind of learned?
In terms of the technique.
Yeah.
Like.
No, like as far as what, well, just, you know, you'll know this has got to be bass heavy. It's got a groove. There's a, you got to play on the fat side of the one. Like, is there's like something like seriously, like insider, like what's the secret of what makes people go batshit crazy and why people have sex and a good time when it comes to,
don't
you
do
know,
too much.
Yeah.
Don't too much. Like,
don't keep
don't
it
do
simple.
Too much.
Yeah.
The simple. Groove, the groove is happening. Like if a young musician is going to work on something, it's like, get your rhythm down and your time feel, you know?
Yeah.
That's like, I think the agree. Most it's, important thing.
Yeah. It's, I mean, I don't think there's any big magical secret other than you just practice. And it's like, it's weird. It's like a cycle of unlearning stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like when you're a teenager, like I remember for myself, I wanted to play all the Danny Carey and Neil Peart.
Super fast, super complex.
And I still like, the part of me still likes to mess around with that.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
When we get together and play, I think now, like, if we are going to add any of that, it's from, like, a fusion aspect of, like, throwing in, like, we were talking about throwing in some, like, Latin rhythms or, you know, some world music stuff. Corey's actually, like, really well-versed in, like, the guitar land of doing that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know? Like adding that sort of like he's our jazz guy.
I went to Mohawk for like I played bass and sang in a Beatles band, and then I was like 1 year classical guitar major and then 2 years jazz guitar major.
Right.
And talking about like you said earlier about like feeling like the weight or like trying to make it in the music industry, I had to like unlearn a lot of what I learned in school because of such a competitive place, you know, the kind of like drives the love out of you. Like, you gotta practice more.
Very, very binary method of gauging, calculating success in such a in any arts, you know. But it's even when it comes down to, you know, you could debauch, you know, you could bring the who is it? For someone is like, excuse me. There's two types of people. There's the daytime people, the nighttime people, and the job of the nighttime people is to take the money of the daytime people. And when you kind of start, you throw yourself to the dark side, literally, where it's like, I'm now an entertainer. This is what I'm doing. I have to entertain. Yeah. I think it's like it behooves. No, seriously, it's like you're not working in. You guys, for your age, for 30, you know, didn't spend your whole life in a lab. You know, you seriously saw what worked and what didn't, what got you paid and what didn't, what people liked, and even if you weren't playing anymore, what they asked for over and over. And I can't say that enough, because you're obviously not harking to any style, but I feel with your original stuff, it is so, it embodies that and has a positivity and has a biometric effect. Why don't you show it in real time? And this is what we do here is we play, we weren't sure. You came in and helped with the Macification of the studio. This is the very first show, by the way, that's being multi-tracked and being recorded on a Mac. Yeah. You know, we were a strictly PC computer up until this very show. Ooh. So there's that.
Yes.
You know, and so we don't, you know, with 16 Apollo inputs and then, you know, some other ones, it's you got to watch the number of mic inputs. So having someone come in a stripped down form like you're able to do and still, you know, impart so much of the feel of the music is, first of all, commendable to you guys. Really appreciate you coming in and doing that. Because not everyone can. You know, a lot of times it is all the makeup and the heels, but... Not you guys. You guys look great naked. That's
Thank
what I'm
you.
Trying to get
try.
Musically speaking, what are you going to do for us live?
This song's called Still Amazed. Cool. Another new song that's not on the EP.
These are all.
This is great because these are all premieres. World premiere songs, and you can get this, and
we're just all about giving more bang for your buck.
More
you know?
Bangs.
Yeah.
All about the W.
All right. And what's it? You want to tell us about it?
This song actually has more of a clear message. Yeah. The last one, not so much, kind of stream of consciousness. This one, I've been living with my girlfriend the past couple of years. So this one really came from me thinking about just all the crap that she deals with me. Yeah. And how I can find that, you know, amazing or whatever, that she can be so so persistent and supportive of me when there's fights and my craziness and
awesome
and phones.
Sounds good. It's not me anymore. And it's a drummer too, right?
Of course.
When he finds
always
out,
at the worst times. Worst timing.
He's been.
What is Les
not hired?
Les Claypool's wife.
Or she's not hired. You don't want to be
your sense of time is sense of timing is impeccable, but your sense of time is.
It's funny.
Is it left to be desired?
It left to be desired. I've heard it before. It's old.
Or something like that. I don't know.
All right. So were we done you telling us what it was about?
Yeah.
All right.
Sure. That's it.
Let's hear it right here, right now.
All
right. Live, barbershoppodcast.com.
This one features Corey's sweet jazz chords.
Hang your soul on the hook in the hall. You hang your head when you're 10 feet tall. Hear the silence under the floor. Be on the bad side of a slam door.
No matter what you say, I'm still amazed by you.
then. Lovely. Slo Motions, you can get a sound and a look and a feel. They're on YouTube. We're going to share some love with that shortly. You can get a hold of this CD. The links will be on the site. Look for the Hourglass Egg Timer. You know, there's all kinds of there's Masonic messages in here, and so it's like you want those because you're gonna. I can't get into much detail, but when the end comes, the secret programming that's on this CD will save your life.
You gotta stay woke.
You do, you know, and it's like, and you can't just tell people straight out because they're like, oh, I'm bored. You know, it's like, okay, we'll just implant those messages in your mind through music. Is that okay? And they're like, yeah. Say accept, right? So, you know, it's like you've all by watching this episode accepted. So it's good to see. Join. It's all good. All right. Speaking of joining, join tax season. Let's talk about taxes. Let's not talk about taxes. God, I hate taxes. I hate numbers. But it's a good thing because we have people who slay that shit for you. Taxes done right. You know what? Because they deal with musicians. They deal with people like you and me, you know, who aren't that great at it. But you've got all sorts of benefits. There is love for you out there, financial love. And I guarantee if you call them over there, Heather takes care of stuff over at Taxes Done Right. There's their number. I mean, really, at the end of the day, you need it done and you're trying to remember where to get it done. You know, look up one of our episodes. It should be tagged on there. That's the number. Call it. Someone's going to answer. And then the conversation starts. All right. So tell them that you heard about it through, you know, Barbershop Podcast, or you're a member of Boxo Studios Peoples, or Barbershop Podcast of Peoples. There's, you know, give you an extra 5%. They're cheaper than H&R Block. They don't rip you off. It's great. You got to know people. You got to know someone, right? Mm-hmm. And there's a world of knowing someone. It's like, where do you go? I don't know. I go some place where they put a flunky in the mall, you know? And I'm sorry if you're one of the flunkies in the mall. Nothing against you. You got to make your money when you can, right? But, oh, they're shysters. And I don't mean to use the word shyster as a Yiddish appropriation. I'm not like that, okay? It's like this is a world where... Yeah. It's getting harder and harder to say things. And all I say is there's love out there. There's love and humor. And laughing again is, oh, my God, that's so important.
Laughing's
that's
back.
What comedians are important, and laughing is back. Mm-hmm. Take a deep breath. Man, it's good. It's kind of like, remember WrestleMania 13 when... No, I'm not going there. Even I don't remember WrestleMania 13. All right. Let's talk about videos. Let's talk about Ryan Cannon. I mean, he's humble, but what? He's a great videographer, right?
Yeah, man.
And he did this video, and again, talking about humor and talking about the ability to laugh. And always said, don't take yourself too seriously. Take what you do very seriously, right? You kind of live by that.
And, I like that. That's good. Yeah. I've never said that before, but now I will.
Yeah, that's the secret there, you know, and they don't go crazy and you get respect. And that's what we're all looking for at the end of the day. Just respect me and please, I don't want to go crazy. So let's talk, you know, about this, about Straight Shooter.
Is it
representative in any way spectacularly, or you just, why'd you pick this one to say, okay, let's make the video?
I think out of all the songs, Straight Shooter was the one that I think we enjoyed the most. We said, okay, that's where we kind of see things going. It was,
It's definitely the most fun.
It's the most fun. It's the most upbeat.
It's the single.
It was like we kind of had the feeling that was the single. So we're like, we got to do that one. And then obviously the song is about, just trying to be like a straight up honest person, you know, say what
in
you mean.
In this world,
instead of beating around the bush and kind of... Oh, I think that was me saying, like the song, I'm a real straight shooter, is like me writing it being like, I'm not, I want to be, so I'm just going to say this, that I am, you know?
repeat the mantra, exactly, because it's been beaten.
Positive self-talk.
It's been beaten out of us, right?
Now I'm seeing the theme here.
and then the whole idea of, you know, cowboys and, you know, the shooters came in, and so I remember having that idea, which clearly was, a subconscious memory of a Primus video for
Big Brown Beaver.
After we made the video, he's like, this looks a lot like Primus's Wynonna's Big Brown Beaver. And you're like, oh yeah, you're right. Because, you know, they're dressed up as cowboys in it. But
they're plastic. We're a real deal, man.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. There's a lot of differences. But there was an homage to it, unconscious homage, I guess.
And I got to give big ups to my step-cousin Matt Ricci, who
came to the plate that day and put on the bear suit.
Bear suit, because it was a tough gig. And
it was a hot day. It was hot. It was the middle of July or whatever it was.
We all got rashes.
You must suffer for your art. You must always suffer for your art. Well, you got the least amount of suffering right now as the viewer of Barbershop Podcast. This fantastic video, straight shooter, just like Barbershop Podcast, straight up, straight from the heart. Barbershoppodcast.com. Barbershop Podcast, where you get this kind of good stuff all the time. I'm telling you, don't tell anyone. And I'm not Larry, the guy with the snake on his face, nor am I Mayor Tommy Shanks. I am Kevin Barber, your host. And it is an amazing thing that Barbershop Podcast does. We do it week in, week out. You can avail yourself of it free of charge. I mean, right now, there's people in Colorado, there's people in Argentina, there's people in Australia watching this show, right? And the number of views we have over 4 years is infinitesimal compared to ones of girls pooping in cups and things like that. Like, I'm serious. Like, it's not a 30-second fart joke we do here. It is like over an hour long professional show that showcases original music that exists in your hometown and your city. It is a industry that you know, it's not thriving. Everyone says, is it thriving? It's no. It's full of incredible entrepreneurs who do about 8 or 10 different jobs themselves on top of the job they have to do to support their passion. And it is legitimate as it comes. It is good. And we show that every week. And when you get to the point where you don't give a fuck what someone who knows nothing thinks or says, you're going to do all right. And it doesn't matter what facet of your life you do that in. It just happens to be music here. These are people who are really good at boiling the life shit down into a jam that people like you can put on a cracker and digest. And but people like you, I just mean you go about the daily life, you enjoy the end product, like the way I enjoy a computer. I'm an end user. I'm very creative when I have a mouse in my hand, but I don't fucking understand the shit that goes into it, neither do you. And when it comes to music, I understand a bit more. And it's the one thing where I've seen the guts and it still doesn't disgust me. Okay, and there's so much in this world that disgusts me, the business, the industry end of this, the cliqueism, the fishing hole protection, the whole bullshit that goes on with it, I don't like. But the music itself has never let me down, never disappointed me, and the people involved in it tend to be good people. You don't get away with shit too long in this business before you're found out, and I like that. I like that. I really don't have an enemy in this world unless that's your gig, you know, that's what you started, and surrounding yourself with people who give a shit and put their heart on their sleeve. And I don't mind if you're cloying and cute as you put your heart on your sleeve, because sometimes that's how we meet girls and fall in love, just like that's the way we write songs. So who am I to say there's one way? But I talk about real music, and sometimes people take me on about that, and I just say real music is just, it's real music. You can reproduce it live, you know, and I don't care if it's you humming and with a teacup, you know, but you can make it happen live. And, you know, it connects, you know, and I look at something like EDM and I see that it connects.
Yeah.
But I don't consider it real music. I consider it performance. I consider it, you know, a show. You know, it definitely, like, it's an aspect. When we went to a real, our first real rock show, I went, oh, my God, like, on top of the music, there's this other thing. There's these lights and this smoke and this pageantry that goes with real music. And then someone went, well, fuck the band. Let's just keep the, you know, the bullshitty end of it. And then it's way, you know,
Yeah.
And I feel bad for the people who haven't felt the human element, you know?
Yeah.
The difference between a vibrator and the D, I guess. You know? The good D, you for know.
Sure. You need that warmth.
Yeah.
Yeah. And now everyone's gonna be like, oh, it's groaning worldwide. All right. Let's play another tune. That'll make them forget anything.
All right.
Do you have a particularly homoerotic song you wanna play for us right now?
Set the Ace.
Yeah, this song's called Set the Ace or Set the Pace. Actually, Set the Pace. At a medium
We're finished.
Pace.
We're done. We're
At
done.
A pace.
We're done. All right. That's as far as I'm going to go. I'm just getting through it, and they're going to play it. You're going to hear it right here, right now on barbershoppodcast.com.
the while you set the while you set the while you set the while you set the
Well done. Well presented, well thought out. And do you have any stinkers? Is pretty much everything you kind of come by that you can like hammer it into shape and go, well, that's good? Or are there ones where it's just like,
oh, we got stinkers. Oh, yeah. We've written some stinkers.
Yeah. And you guys are very catchy. There's probably a lot of bits.
No one knows.
Bits, yeah. Lots of bits you got.
I think most big bands, there's no big band that's like, you know, okay, these are the 10 songs of the record. Those are the 10 songs we wrote. Like, no, it's whittled down from like 200 songs,
yes,
right?
Yes.
It's like 80% of the time it's just crap. And then you find those like, you know.
Unless you're Paul McCartney.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, you know, it's like, man, there's Paul McCartney albums that like,
He's admitted to writing some stinkers.
Yeah, tedious.
Because it's not a, you know, even if you're on top of the world, you're not there all the time. You know,
no,
I think it's a human thing. It's like sometimes you had a shit week or something, and you know, like,
I think it's you know? Exactly that's it, and I think it really is for something to resonate. It's no different than a politician or a newscast or anyone else who's in the public eye and under the gun. You have to resonate with Main Street, you know, and sometimes it's the kids in the cul-de-sac, and sometimes it's the kids downtown, but there's always a group of people who go, my God, that's what I'm thinking and feeling. And certainly, you know, I mean, there's an ugly music group and a beautiful music group. You know, there's people who see commercialization as a bad thing. That's a sellout. That's not real music. And other people who clearly see it merely as a vehicle for something else. It's not one thing. You know, this is what I've loved. Yeah. It's just like people are, and I kind of fell in that hole a bit too doing this show, because I was still lionizing a bit more than I should, because, you know, we all start music for different reasons. We're all people. We're all different people. There's no, at the end of the day, real unifying thing that you can really put past, other than obviously someone that, you know, you see it in sports. There's got to be a couple people in there who didn't have necessarily all the gifts bestowed upon them, but gritty through determination, gritted out. But there had to be a passion, you know. There's like someone stops, or just your dad's making you do it, or there's some other outside reason other than, you know, a passion to do it.
And I think drive will always trump talent too.
Yeah. I think you really nailed it. It like comes down to the why or the intent behind the music, not like if you're signed to a major label or if you're like indie, you know.
Yeah.
It's like, why are you doing it in the first place?
There's not a starting and a finishing point. And I think we fool ourselves that we're imaginary, but trying to peg ourselves along a line to making it, right? And what I'd like to see is, I think we could all make a living by cloning the 13 or 25 super fans that we've all amassed over years here worldwide. You know, those people who have those sensibilities and those passions exist in Helsinki and you know, all kinds of places, and then all of a sudden you're making $21,605 a year just doing your thing. You know, I really think that is a realistic goal, to try to make a living for more original musics by using this bubble, because before it was like, does anyone in the band drive? You know, like, you can't even think about having a band unless you had someone who drove and someone had a vehicle, like a van or a trailer. There were absolute logistics. It had to be someone's dad who was into the band, someone who had a brother who was into the band.
Well, those are all things that we've
lived with growing up, too, right?
Yeah, totally, And even now, it's like, we need cars to get to the gigs.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, you need to, you know, we're fortunate enough to rehearse at where Corey and I teach at Capstone Music School. But, I mean, you got to pay, now that you're out of mom and dad's basement, you got to pay to play, or, you know, like, everyone lives in apartments, you got to rent rehearsals.
And so many amazing musicians become teachers and real estate agents and things, and it's like, they have to give up music. It's not that, for any other reason than that, you know, it's like, oh, okay, I've passed, that's a youthful endeavor. Well, as long as, you know, it's an expense, you know, it is a youthful endeavor.
I think you, if you really believe in something and you really feel...
Yes.
Like, you get that buzz from it, you know what I mean? There's going to be a lot of pain.
Yeah.
But the longer you stick it out and the more, you know.
I think there's a balancing that's happening. Yeah. Where before, who you blew and who you knew to get a deal. And then it was like, anyone can have a fucking record. You know, literally anyone can put a record out. So who gives a shit if you have a record? And there's now kind of a... through process, we're getting to the point where, okay, there can be young, unsigned, unheralded talent that could put out a quality listening.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
we've got a studio here we put together for $30,000 that I think stacks up with studios that in the day.
That's the thing. It's amazing. And that's nice technology word. Is technology is like totally like
evolved.
It's both ways, right? Like it's like we can make records here now in this room. And in my back room at my house.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it has totally devalued music, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Which is,
especially with like what you said earlier about like EDM and, you know, pop music and auto-tune.
I saw
and...
a great meme that you made me think of.
Yeah.
It was like in 1970, people paid $4, to go see a band. Like 30,000 people went to go see a band for $4. And now people in 2017... pay $400 to go see a laptop.
Yeah.
It's pretty crazy.
Yeah. And I think
not knocking anyone that does it.
No,
I mean,
but
I think
all those people should at least have gone or, you know, and I don't care if you force them, march them in, but they should have to see a live music show. They have to know what they're missing. And then you make the choice that this is all I want, or I don't even say be elitist and clap, but it's like, honestly believe it's just they kill the golden goose a number of ways, and by they I do mean municipal governments and stupid little legislations and things that just made it harder for venues to showcase live music and for the patrons of live music to go out and enjoy themselves. I'm not going to get into the specifics of it, but something changed where they didn't realize that that's going to happen, and there's a whole generation now who's never had a band come to their high school and never gone snuck out and gone in and seen a cool live band live and been affected for life.
Right.
And then the first place they go with their friends where they have a good time, so EDM festival, and why not? But it's like, I think there really is, and I love music. I love a good stereo system, but you walk into a live room when it's cooking, there's a third dimension that hits you musically. And they say there's 75 or 80 rooms in Hamilton that play music, and I know there's 3 or 4 clubs, you know, that play music where people go to see music. And even then, it's a fight sometimes.
Yeah.
Where you're going there to see the music, not that we have a room and there's a band playing in the corner. Hopefully, they won't be too loud and get in your way of talking about yourself. You know, there's, you know, I've seen it time and time again. Go in, and the least busy room in the whole bar is where the band is. And
it just blows especially in the summertime when the patios are rocking.
Yeah.
The bar is packed, but you're inside playing to no one.
Yeah,
it's weird,
it's
man.
It's crazy.
Yeah, man. Well, it's like, I don't blame the people, you know, because over the past like 16, 17 years, you know, music has really taken, like what you said, like the human element out of it. So the stuff that you're talking about, like the energy in the room, the emotion of the band playing, you know, the blending of people's energy that's happening in that moment, that's like, you know, like, it won't happen again like that, exactly like that. And that's like the nature of it.
Yes.
You know, like when you go out in nature and you hear a bird sing.
Yes.
You're not going to hear that exactly the same, you know.
Yes, well put.
Yeah, very well
put. We're going deep here tonight. There's just enough beer to go deep enough tonight, but not too deep. Going to play another one off of the CD that is so good. You know, I got mine. You know, I had to wrestle a gator for it.
Wrestle.
I wrestled it, and I won.
Wrestlemania.
I won. This one's called Hang Tight. is another uplifting, kind of seems like it, right? You know, hang in there, baby. Hang tight.
This one's like full throttle, like rock.
It's upbeat. This one's
balls out.
Yeah.
And then Adam and I came up with this jazz sort of jazz breakdown wackiness part in the middle of the song.
It made it happen. And,
but we were just kind of like, why not? Whatever. There was a big whatever. We don't care. And
let's just try it.
Cool. Full speed ahead. Hang tight. Barbershoppodcast.com. Fantastic. Oh, you got to like Slow Motions. I do. Barbershop Podcast does. Always. This is a crazy special Saturday afternoon episode. It's a pleasure to have the house full of sunshine and love and everything that's going on in the void today. What do you got going on? What's the next little chunk of time? Kind of call for your attention and passion.
We're going to record some songs.
Canoe.
Gunu. I thought that too. That's a little
We're Gunu. Gunu. Is that a Canadian thing? I don't know.
Gunu? My mom says Guinea. That's
Guinea?
Totally,
we are going Guinea. To. we're going to cut a couple tracks with our buddy Brandon. He has a studio out in Aurora, friend of ours. And just do a couple singles, you know, just to keep keep some logs on the fire, you know, keep throwing stuff up on the old interwebs.
Yes.
In between gigs and stuff like that. Yep. And
do like a single B-side.
Like
type
Julian
deal.
Assange, you know, yeah. I'm still alive. Yeah. I'm not gone anywhere. We're
just keep every once in a while, just keep throwing stuff up there as much as we can afford to do.
Right. And, we just need to keep creating content right now.
And something like this, where now people are going to stumble upon it and go, where can I get a copy of this? Which I imagine like the band camps and the,
Slo Babies. And, Spotify.
Spotify. The interweb. All you have to do is Slo Motions. Slo.
S-L-O.
S-L-O dash motions. With no apostrophe. It's right there. It's like you'll see it. Right over my head. Right. I'm on YouTube right now. Mentally eyeing it.
Yeah. Nice.
Coming back to, again, promoting, getting the word out, getting the face out, getting the tunes out, another video, Payday. And who doesn't love Payday, right?
That's right.
Payday is a trigger word for fun, I think, you know.
Yeah.
You know. Although it can be very depressing because you made, you know, you took home $411 and you owe $446 and you have 2 weeks to not eat. Yeah, it's like sometimes it's a reminder of
what's real.
What real,
that's
right?
Real. The system.
This unwinnable game called life. It's like, in what level is this thing set on?
Expert.
Slo Motions Payday of barbershoppodcast.com. We'll be right back. Barbershop Podcast every week, guys. Thanks so much for coming in. Love it every time. Yes, wish you all the best in life. For Gary Greenland, Ryan Cannon, I'm Kevin Barber, your host of Barbershop Podcast. We'll see you next week. Come on, baby, won't you let me in? I've been living in original sin. I'm dying to keep trying. Can't you see what kind of sheep I'm in? Start a step of shutter in. You're selling. Well, I'm buying. Get to it.